If you listened to the radio in the early aughts, or simply had any interest in electronic music since then, this melody should be familiar to you. However, the information regarding the artist behind this song, and how it came to be, is likely much less familiar, especially for such a recognizable melody. I've had a fascination with this song since first hearing it, and decided to learn as much as I could about the history and significance that it holds. The further I looked, the more intriguing the story became. And so, I'd like to share that story. This is Better Off Alone by Alice Deejay. Let's start with the basics. How, when, and by whom the song was created, which are actually more complicated questions than you might think. 1997, Groningen, a city in the north of the Netherlands. This is the setting in which childhood friends Sebastian Pronti Molijn and Ilke Kalmani Kalberg produced and released their first track together, called Distortion of the Senses, under the moniker Psychonaut. This track was an instant hit in Dutch nightclubs. The two young producers who created this track are the protagonists of this story. In that same year, the pair met famed radio host Deejay Jurgen Rijkers, DJing at a club in their hometown. He had recently begun producing music of his own, in addition to his radio work. After Jurgen's set that night, Molijn and Kalberg would invite him to a private studio to listen to their music. Deejay Jurgen agreed, and was ecstatic to learn that Molijn and Kalberg were the producers behind Distortion of the Senses, a personal favorite track of his, which he had been DJing at shows for weeks. "My God, are you those guys?" Jurgen recalls asking the pair after learning this fact. This revelation spurred Deejay Jurgen to connect with Molijn and Kalberg, and thus the three decided to collaborate. In short order, the trio produced several tracks together. Not long after the start of their musical collaboration, Deejay Jurgen introduced Molijn and Kalberg to Dennis Dansky van der Driessen and Wessel del Mundo van Diepen, who were already well-established DJs and producers, famous in Holland for their work with acts such as Nakatomi and LA Style, and who would soon see international success thanks to their latest project, Venga Boys. Van der Driessen and van Diepen served more as mentors and industry guides than musical collaborators. However, their influence was paramount to the success that the young producers were on the very cusp of. In 1998, during sessions with Deejay Jurgen, Molijn and Kalberg wrote the foundation for what would become Better Off Alone. Initially, the track was instrumental. Side note, Wikipedia lists the recording date for Better Off Alone as 1997, and even cites four sources. However, none of the primary sources claim that Better Off Alone was recorded in 1997, and instead refer to their previous hit, Distortion of the Senses. The only source to claim that Better Off Alone was created in 1997 is a passing reference by Dash Berlin in a 2014 interview. It's likely that he was mistaken, however, as all other evidence points to 1998 as the origin point for Better Off Alone. Upon hearing the first instrumental mix, Van Diepen suggested the addition of vocals to the track, so that the song could more easily become a hit. Thus, Judith Prunk was enlisted to provide vocals for the track. Lyrics were written by Molijn, inspired by a recent breakup he experienced. "Do you think you're better off alone?" was the phrase that he pitched for lyrics and served as the basis for nearly the entire lyrical content. In addition to providing vocals, Prunk served as the face of the newly minted project, now known as Alice Deejay. Much like Venga Boys and van der Driessen's and van Diepen's previous successful acts, Alice Deejay was an outlet for a crew of producers to create catchy dance pop anthems with an idol figure to serve as the public-facing image. The producers and songwriters behind the creation of the music itself, however, remained obscured. This structure was the brainchild of Van der Drieschen and Van Diepen, and resulted in them both receiving producer credits for songs released by Alice Deejay. So to recap, from a public perspective, Alice Deejay seems to be the project of one person, assumedly named Alice. After all, aside from a few backup dancers, Pronk is the only person involved with the production to ever be featured on album artwork, music videos, or even in live performances. In fact, even the official Spotify biography for Alice Deejay refers to the artist as her, even though it does concede that the singer is actually named Judy. In truth, the music was created by no less than six people at various levels of production and songwriting, from Mo Lane and Kalberg writing and recording tracks, to Deejay Jürgen assisting with production, akin to the traditional notion of a producer in a studio setting, to Pronk providing vocals and dance performance, and finally to Van Diepen and Van der Drieschen formulating a public image and essentially supervising and managing the project as a whole. Most musical artists are inextricably linked with their music. This is especially true in the realm of pop music. An artist's persona, as well as their personal details and background, all shape the image of their body of work, even if that background is often embellished or even outright fabricated. However, Alice Deejay represents the opposite perspective at play, and instead portrays the image of a pop star that is truly and wholly manufactured. This was also true for most of Van Diepen's and Van der Drieschen's other projects, especially Vinga Boys. This structuring could even be found in other electronic projects of the time, such as Rednecks, which was a project conceived by three Swedish producers, but fronted by up to 16 non-musician performers, and later acts like Crazy Frog, a virtual artist represented by a CGI-animated frog, for which the music is actually a collaboration between several German producers and a ringtone company. Music can be understood and explored in innumerable ways. To speak about music is to necessarily speak in metaphors. Everything that we express about music has a layer of abstraction to translate it into a methodology that we can understand and reproduce, such as notation. Nothing about the note G necessitates that it be referred to as such, nor does the pitch formalized as G have any distinguishing features, apart from any other frequency, that makes it special. It's simply a set number of oscillations of a pressure wave that our brain interprets as a particular pitch, and our systems refer to as G. This is all to say that musical analysis is arbitrary, but can be useful in furthering our understanding of any given work. For Better Off Alone, I decided to look at the following aspects to see what I could learn. Rhythm, melody, harmony, timbre, and expression. Analyzing these elements separately can help to make sense of a work, but it's important to note that every element works in tandem with the others, and many, many others, beyond just these five, to create the comprehensive whole. For example, a melody, by definition, must have rhythm of some sort. A timbre must have pitch content of some kind, and even the most rigid of interpretations is still an expression. Let's start our analysis journey with a quick look at the rhythm. We can first establish some basics. The track is 137 BPM, which was well within the standard range for popular electronic music of that era. The majority of the song features a four-on-the-floor driving bass drum, with hi-hat hits on each upbeat. The most commonly associated genres with the track are Eurodance, which is essentially an umbrella term for simple, radio-friendly electronic dance music, which had peak prominence in 1990s Europe, trance, which is a style also associated with mainland Europe during the 1990s, typically associated with layers of sound, intended to create a drifting trance-like state in the listener, and house, which is largely defined by the presence of the four-on-the-floor beat, as well as female vocals. Better Off Alone combines elements from all three of these genres, especially via rhythm. The syncopated synth line, which complements the pulsating bass, implies trance with its hypnotic sawtooth tones, not to mention the swirling choir of synths it's built upon. The snare buildups help to establish Eurodance conventions by winding up tension, much like the lead-up to a drop in more modern electronic dance music. All in all, though, the rhythm of the track is quite simple, which is to be expected of a successful pop hit of the late 90s. Much more complicated and interesting, however, is the melody for the track. Most pop melodies are primarily diatonic. That means that the notes of the melody don't stray from the key signature of the song. There are 7 unique notes in the diatonic scale from which melodies can be drawn. If you've ever played a scale on a keyboard, the notes played are the diatonic notes of the key, capped off with the octave, which is the same note as the first note in the scale and twice the frequency of that first note. Better Off Alone is especially unique due to the fact that despite its 4-bar looping synth lead, 6 of the 7 notes of the diatonic scale are used to create the melody. This is especially interesting when the context of similar songs from the era are considered. Eurodance, and more generally electronic dance music from the late 90s, tends to have a reputation for brainlessly simple melodies, often with single notes repeated ad nauseum, cue Darude Sandstorm. To have emerged from this scene, the central melody for Better Off Alone seems even more beautiful and elegant in its complexities. Better Off Alone also bucks pop music trends, and how its most iconic melodic line is not sung, but rather part of the instrumental. However, the vocal melody also serves an important role as a sort of counter-melody to the lead synth. The relationship between these melodies is unusual, as the role of the vocal is to provide longer sustained notes with very simple motion, while the synth hops around the keyboard, never finding a moment to rest. The synth melody in particular has also been sampled and interpolated in a number of other pop hits from artists such as Wiz Khalifa and David Guetta. The only thing we know how to do. Said it's the only thing we know how to do. Work hard, play hard, work hard, play hard, we work hard. As well as covered by Purity Ring, San Holo, and many others. The legacy of this melody wasn't already secure. These reinterpretations certainly helped to spread it to much wider audiences. For a song initially labeled as catchy, but ultimately a throwaway, by Entertainment Weekly, Better Off Alone has proven itself to have one of the most iconic and memorable melodies in dance music. And for every great melody, there must be a harmony to underpin and support its adventures. The harmony for Better Off Alone does just that, with its smart structure and fluid motion. The track is in the key of G-sharp minor, a rather novel choice, and the chord progression throughout the entire song is major 6, minor 5, minor 1, major 7. This is nearly the exact same chord progression, even in the same key, as Heads Will Roll by Yeah Yeah Yeahs, which became a dance floor anthem about 10 years after the release of Better Off Alone, in large part due to an electro house remix from A-Track. It's not at all surprising that both of these iconic dance tunes share the same harmony, as this progression was practically tailor-made for the dance floor. The harmony starts in medias res, on the 6th chord, with resolution to minor 1 only found in the 3rd bar, and rebuilding tension to 6, to allow for seamless and ceaseless looping. If the progression were to begin or end with the 1 chord, each loop would be discrete, with much more finality, which doesn't lend itself as well to a dance track as it functions in a club setting. As it is, the harmony for Better Off Alone is engaging, easily digestible, and endlessly loopable. Next up, timbre. Timbre can be described as the color of sound. It's what makes the same note played on different instruments sound different. Each instrument has its own frequency profile, which is what alters timbre. Better Off Alone utilizes entirely synthesized sounds, aside from Pronk's vocals. In fact, the only album ever released by Alice Deejay is entitled Who Needs Guitars Anyway? But nonetheless, there are still layers of different instruments, each with different timbres to distinguish their roles in the song. This textural variation helps to ease the listening experience and ensure that the ear doesn't tire of hearing any one sound. From the bubbly yet smooth bass, to the ethereal choir of pads that erupt for brief moments throughout. Of all the sounds in the track, undoubtedly the most memorable is the lead synth. This lead is an unfiltered sawtooth wave, which has the ability to pierce through the many atmospheric layers to stand out above the other sounds. The use of filters throughout the song helps to shape the sound in real time, allowing for smooth transitions between sections, and again bolstering the knack that the song has for perpetual motion. Finally, a look at the expression of the song is warranted. Now, what do I mean by expression? By expression, I'm referring to the way that a track indicates mood and feeling, or the spirit of the song. Usually, when expression is examined in music, it's in reference to how a piece is performed, whether that be through the subtleties of different interpretations of the same piano sonata, or the immense passion a performer expresses through their performance. But in this case, Better Off Alone only has one real human element, the vocal delivery. Obviously, the lyrics of the song are extraordinarily simple, with only two lines repeated for the duration. The meaning couldn't be more clear. The singer is asking their partner if they'd be better off alone, and pleads for them to talk. Pronk's delivery adds intrigue, though. With her wry, self-assured tone, she sings as if she already knows the answer to the question. Her partner is sure as hell not better off without her. When she tells her love to talk to her, she does so sweetly, but with a sort of wink to the audience during the croon. She's in control of the situation, and she knows that she's not going to be alone. Now, to put it together. Clearly, the breakdown I've provided thus far is no more than scratching the surface. I've avoided any strict theory analysis or a full examination at the actual structure of the song. The point I'd like to make here, though, is that there is value in taking a close look at music, and that you don't need any professional knowledge or skill set to uncover this information. That's one of the things that I enjoy most about music. You can appreciate it on so many different levels. From just barely hearing a song while in line at the grocery store, to rediscovering a song that you haven't heard in years but remember all of the lyrics to, from expanding your horizons with sounds you're entirely unfamiliar with, to spending weeks researching and scrutinizing a single Eurodance one-hit wonder. And all of that is not to mention the act of creating and performing music, which is both jubilant and fulfilling in its own way. Better Off Alone may not be regarded as a masterwork of pop songwriting, but upon close inspection, I have found the song to be intensely interesting. And perhaps its status as a dated bubblegum pop hit from a bygone era helps to prove the point that it is valuable to look into the depth of all types of music. It was certainly unexpected and fascinating to me when I learned that the song's melody was much more complex than most of the era, and that no fewer than six people were behind the artist known simply as Alice Deejay. But why does this matter? What's the point? Well, for me, what this project has shown me more than anything is that all music has untold depths, and exploring those different facets is both exciting and important. Every song has a plethora of stories to tell. All it takes is a bit of digging, a careful listen, and a bit of curiosity. Thank you so much for listening. I truly hope you enjoyed this story and analysis, and I encourage you to discover your own untold stories in your favorite songs. I welcome any and all feedback about this project. Please let me know your thoughts, and if you have any other ideas for future topics to examine. So once again, thank you. I'll be speaking with you again soon.